The film begins by showing a tense scene as the camera focuses on a man named Matthew, a notorious robber with a daring plan. Alongside his criminal accomplice, Judas Jack, they set their sights on the wealthy banker's vaults in the city, daring to steal directly from the source. The following day, as the bankers report the daring heist, Detective Frank Baskin arrives on the scene to investigate the theft. The skilled thief, Matthew, has managed to make off with a treasure trove of valuable goods, including one of the city's most expensive watches. But Matthew is not one to let his loot sit idly by. He swiftly exchanges his stolen goods for cold hard cash with the help of two fence for hire, Danny Jones. As the transaction goes smoothly, Matthew walks away a free man, relishing in the luxurious spoils of his daring heist. Unfortunately, Matthew's newfound wealth was short-lived. Within just 3 weeks, his criminal partner Judas had made a fatal mistake, selling his loot to the wrong people. He was soon arrested as well, facing a sentence of 3 years in prison. Despite the harsh reality of their situation, both Matthew and Judas accepted their fate, understanding the inherent risks involved in their line of work. In prison, Matthew found himself in a cell with a Hungarian mobster named Zoltan. Over time, the two became familiar, striking up conversations and exchanging tales of their respective illegal businesses. One day, as the two sat in their cell, Zoltan received a call from his boss. It seemed that the boss was in need of a reliable thief for an upcoming break-in job, and Zoltan knew just the person for the job, his cellmate, Matthew. Finally, after serving his 3-year sentence, Matthew was a free man once again. The thought of returning to his life of crime filled him with excitement and relief, as he knew that success and treasure were just within reach. As previously agreed, Matthew met with Zoltan's boss, a dangerous woman by the name of Erzsébet. The leader of the Hungarian mafia, Erzsébet was infamous for her ruthlessness, but her gracious demeanor and soft-spoken words masked her true nature. People never suspected that she was the mastermind behind one of the city's most dangerous criminal organizations. After quizzing Matthew and studying his demeanor, Erzsébet was impressed with his competence and quickly assessed his potential for the job. She then explained the details of their target, Hatton Garden Industries. If they were successful, this theft would go down in history as the largest heist of all time. However, the task was not going to be easy. Matthew would need access to keys and alarm codes to disable the surveillance cameras and other security measures. It was a challenging task that required a combination of intelligence, skill, and nerves of steel. It's been 3 long years since Danny saw his old friend, Matthew. The two men were reunited under the cover of a thrilling proposal. Matthew had an ambitious plan to pull off the most daring robbery the city of London had ever seen. At first, Danny was skeptical. He'd heard tales like this before, empty promises from ex-cons trying to make a quick buck. But something was different about Matthew. He was a man of his word, and even though it meant risking everything, he always followed through on his promises. So, Danny agreed to join Matthew on this dangerous adventure. It was clear from the start that this was going to be no ordinary robbery. The Hatton Garden Storage Vault, the largest jewelry company in the city, was their target. Breaking into it would be no small feat. Danny had a long history of running illegal businesses and had made many connections with expert thieves over the years. However, many of these skilled criminals were now in their golden years and not as easily swayed as their younger counterparts. Danny knew he would need to choose his approach wisely and pick the right moment to make his move. As the city buzzed with anticipation of the impending robbery, Frank found himself drawn back into the world of criminal pursuit. Once a renowned detective who had successfully captured Matthew, Frank had retired from the force and was now living a quiet life. However, when he received a call from Marcus Ford, a high-ranking official in the city, his quiet days were over. Marcus informed Frank that the Hungarian mafia had tasked Matthew with breaking into the Hatton Garden safe. And, in a twist of fate, Marcus had a personal interest in one of the storage boxes with the number 175. He needed Frank's expertise to help retrieve it. Frank, who had always been driven by a sense of justice, agreed to help Marcus. At a funeral for a fallen comrade, Danny caught up with an old friend named Brian Reeder. Brian was a legendary thief in his heyday, known for his cunning and expertise. As they reminisced about old times, Danny shared his big plans for the upcoming heist. He told Brian about his trusted accomplice, Matthew, and how they were going to carry out the biggest break-in in the city's history. When Danny mentioned the target of their heist, Brian's eyes grew wide with recognition. The Hatton Garden Storage Vault was the largest jewelry company in the city of London. Although Brian had initially refused to participate in the heist, he couldn't shake the thought of it from his mind. On the bus ride home, he daydreamed about the thrill of a good break-in and the riches that would come with it. As he pondered his future, he was jolted back to reality when a passenger dropped his tourist map. As he picked it up, Brian realized that he needed a lot of money to ensure that his golden years were filled with freedom and adventure. Brian quickly made a U-turn and headed back to find Danny and Matthew. He had made up his mind, he was in. But before he fully committed, he needed to know more about their employer. Brian grilled Matthew for details, determined to know the name of the person behind the heist. Matthew finally relented and told Brian that the mastermind behind the heist was a Hungarian mobster, a female boss named Erzsébet. With Brian on board, the team was ready to move forward with their plan. But Brian was not about to be a passive participant. He insisted that the heist be done his way, with no room for negotiation. Matthew, knowing Brian's reputation as a stickler for detail, agreed to his terms. With the deal sealed, Brian began to bring in his own trusted allies. He brought in Kenny Collins, a seasoned driver with a keen eye for detail, and Terry, an old friend who was once a master at transportation and logistics. Despite their advanced age, these two were still legends in their own right, with skills that were unmatched by today's younger thieves. Judas was getting ready to depart when he was suddenly approached by Frank. Frank, an ex-cop, questioned Judas about the Hatton Garden break-in, suspecting that the mastermind behind it was someone named Matthew. Judas, intimidated by Frank's background, didn't dare to lie and revealed what he knew about Matthew's involvement in the robbery. He told Frank about how Matthew had hired the legendary thieves of old for the job. Judas was skeptical about the success of the heist, considering that one of the participants was an old and fragile man. However, Frank had a different perspective. He knew Matthew very well and was confident in his abilities. Before departing, Frank put pressure on Judas to report any developments or updates regarding the progress of Matthew's and the other thieves' plans. The next morning, the group of seasoned robbers assembled at the headquarters for the planning stage of their heist. Among them were Collins and Terry, who couldn't stop bragging about their exploits and conquests in their youth, especially when it came to wooing women. Brian and Matthew arrived with the meticulously crafted plan in hand. Brian explained that they would be targeting the storage vault of Hatton Garden, the largest jewelry industry vault in London. Collins and Terry were taken aback by the proposal, skeptical about their chances of success. But Brian was confident. He told the group that Matthew had obtained all the necessary information regarding the security system and would take care of it. All they needed to do was bring in the safecracker and execute the plan. Knowing Brian's reputation as a former genius thief, Collins and Terry trusted him implicitly. And when Brian mentioned the potential payout, estimated at over £100 million, the older thieves knew that it was worth the risk. With everything agreed upon, the plan was set into motion. Each day, Terry was assigned to carefully observe and track the movements of the guards at Hatton Garden. Danny was given the task of procuring the necessary equipment piece by piece through the black market, taking care to make the purchases untraceable. Collins was in charge of finding vehicles that wouldn't raise any red flags and were not linked to any previous theft cases so that if any of them were caught, the car wouldn't draw attention. As the mastermind behind the plan, Brian took it upon himself to go undercover and scout the inside of the building by pretending to be a potential customer interested in storing diamonds there. In his disguise, Brian was able to get a first-hand look at the building's layout and security system, noting the location of the safe and the CCTV cameras. He took care to memorize everything he saw, gathering valuable information for the upcoming heist. After thoroughly observing and taking note of all the details, Brian and Matthew sat down with the floor plans from Hatton Garden and began to plot their entry into the largest safe in London. They carefully considered the best way to create a hole in the building's defenses and make their way inside. After all the preparation and reconnaissance were completed, Brian decided to carry out the theft on Easter Day, when the city would be quiet due to the holiday weekend. This would give them enough time to break into the safe without any interruptions. However, unbeknownst to Brian and the rest of the group, Matthew had struck a deal with Erzsébet, a Hungarian mobster known for both her ruthless efficiency and her tendency to hold others to the same standards. In exchange for the master key and alarm codes, Erzsébet demanded £14 million in jewels. And if the break-in failed, Matthew would pay the debt with his life. As Brian and the other old men were enjoying their coffee and reminiscing about the past, a group of young men nearby started making fun of Terry's story. Feeling his pride as a parent wounded, Terry immediately stood up, ready to teach the young men a lesson. But Brian quickly stepped in, mediating the dispute. He realized that old men like them wouldn't stand a chance against the young men in a physical altercation. So, instead of violence, Brian proposed a game to reconcile the situation. If the young men couldn't answer his question correctly, they would have to apologize to Terry. But if they did manage to guess the answer, Brian would foot the bill for all of them that night. The question he posed was a riddle. The one who created it but didn't want it, the one who bought it but didn't need it, the one who needed it but didn't realize it. What is it? The young men struggled with the question but ultimately gave up. Meanwhile, in a chance encounter, Erzsébet, the Hungarian mob boss, ran into Marcus officials. From their interactions, it was clear that they had a complicated history with each other. The atmosphere between them was tense, and it was evident that their past relationship was far from simple. Matthew was taken aback by Frank's sudden appearance and demand. He knew that Frank was a former cop and a formidable adversary, so he didn't dare to lie. Frank made it clear that he was aware of Matthew's plan to break into Hatton Garden, and that he wouldn't interfere as long as Matthew agreed to give up his share of the loot. Frank was only interested in one specific box, number 175. Easter was fast approaching, but one day before the celebration, disaster struck. Brian suddenly fell unconscious, causing alarm among the group. Concerned for their friend, they rushed to visit him to see if he would be able to participate in the plan as planned. Despite feeling under the weather, Brian was determined to carry on and assured the team that he would definitely be there the next day, even if he might be running a little late. Meanwhile, back at the base, Matthew was greeted by an unexpected visitor. The infamous mobster, Herzibit, had been waiting for him, and her presence filled Matthew with unease. She warned him about Frank's involvement, claiming that he was a treacherous snake who could not be trusted. Matthew tried to assure Herzibit that Frank was no longer a threat. However, Herzibit was not satisfied with this explanation and was disappointed that Matthew was willing to give up his 14 million on Easter without a fight. The next morning, Danny set out to pick up Brian, but the young man forbade him from coming. Collins suggested forcibly kidnapping Brian, but Terry quickly shut down the idea, reminding them that they could end up in prison before they even had a chance to act. With Brian out of the picture, Terry made the decision to proceed with the plan without him. Matthew was determined to change his fate and make a name for himself. He wanted to become known as the greatest thief in the history of London and have his name remembered for generations to come. Dressed in his road repair work clothes, Matthew made his way to Hatton Garden to cover the CCTV cameras with black piles. As he waited for his old colleague to arrive, Frank sent a message to Matthew reminding him of box number 175. Meanwhile, Brian, still feeling a bit under the weather, decided to sneak out while his son was asleep in the living room. He traveled alone on foot before taking a taxi to the scene. As the money-carrying car arrived, Brian made his timely arrival as well. The four old men donned their uniform disguises and entered the building through the side door, using the lock-picking tools they had prepared. Matthew made his way to the security room to turn off the alarm system, using the code obtained from Herzibit. Once the alarm had been completely deactivated, Terry and Brian quickly brought in two large garbage bins filled with breaking equipment. Meanwhile, Collins kept watch in the car, keeping an eye on the situation and ready to report any developments outside the building. Terry had planned to get off the ropes without damaging the elevator, but his aging bones made it difficult for him. He was forced to get off the elevator early and left it open, marking it as broken. Danny and Matthew made their way down a secret shortcut and, after a successful descent, Matthew quickly went to work prying open the door from below using a jack. Once the door was open, he encountered Danny who had arrived first. Danny nonchalantly sat down and enjoyed a coffee while he waited for Brian and his equipment to arrive. Brian was ecstatic as he prepared to use his plan to break into the largest safe. The large drills were taken out of the garbage bins and assembled with heavy modifications to ensure stability during the drilling process. However, after an hour had passed, only a third of the safe's walls had been penetrated, meaning that it would take another 3 hours to get through all the walls. Unfortunately, Terry was starting to tire, unable to follow the plan as effectively as he wanted to. However, since Terry was unfamiliar with the layout of the building, Matthew was forced to abandon the drilling and guide him to the restroom. As Matthew waited for Terry to return from the restroom, he noticed something strange with the building's alarm system. He quickly called Frank, informing him that the alarm was still active and emitting a silent signal. Frank was trying to determine if they had been discovered or not, but he soon realized that the silent alarm was connected to a private security company, not the police station. He had no authority to intervene. Matthew was panicked, and he wanted to call off the mission, but Frank was insistent that they proceed with the plan. They had already come so far. Terry, who was with Matthew, found out about the call and forced Matthew to admit that he had reached out to an ex-cop for help with the alarm. Despite the initial hiccup, the situation was brought under control and the mission proceeded as planned. When Brian discovered the situation, he realized that there was a cost involved and asked Frank what he wanted in return. Matthew, being truthful, revealed that a deal had been struck before the theft was carried out. Frank only wanted box number 175 in exchange for his assistance. The three men briefly hesitated, but Brian ultimately decided to follow through with the deal as there were still many other boxes in the safe. He saw no harm in exchanging a single box for their safety. The drilling resumed, and after nearly 3 hours, they finally succeeded in creating a hole large enough for a person to enter. As the night approached, they took a break to eat dinner and replenish their depleted energy. They all enjoyed their meal with relish. Just then, a young man approached the building, causing Collins to alert the other members over the radio. They immediately stopped their work and went to observe the young man's movements. It turned out that the young man was a night watchman for the neighborhood, who had been disturbed by a phone call from his wife asking for something that was not sold in the middle of the night. Once the young man had left the area, the group was filled with relief and they resumed their drilling. After 3 more hours, they had finally created 3 holes. It was time to push the barrier vault using a hydraulic plunger that they had modified with a drilling machine. However, as they were preparing the equipment, Brian suddenly fainted due to exhaustion. This presented a new problem, as they now had to deal with the electrical and gas lines that were connected to the cable. After all the setbacks they faced, Matthew made the difficult decision to stop and leave the equipment behind. He quickly called Collins and instructed him to wait at the side door of the pickup truck. His top priority at that moment was to save Brian's life. Although they still had 2 days remaining, Matthew was uncertain about whether they should continue with the heist or abandon it. The situation was made even worse when Frank sent a message, demanding that they hand over the box within 24 hours. If the theft was not successful, the police would arrest Matthew and the other senior members. While Danny, Collins, and Terry were sitting at a cafe, unsure of what to do, Brian suddenly called and urged them to continue with the heist. In the middle of his sleep, Matthew was abruptly awoken by a horrifying vision of Erzabet coming towards him, ready to carry out his execution. However, it was just a hallucination. In reality, it was Terry and the other old men who had come to wake him. They convinced Matthew to return to the heist, assuring him that they had purchased a replacement for the broken cable and that all they needed to do was finish the final drilling for their mission to be a success. The four men set off together, with Collins once again waiting in the car. Matthew, Terry, and Danny went inside to reactivate their hydraulic equipment, while Brian, still feeling weak, chose to rest in bed and wait for the outcome of his colleagues' efforts. The process went smoothly, and after turning on the hydraulic equipment and successfully pushing the cabinets down, they finally gained access to the safe. Matthew used an electric key opener to open each storage cabinet one by one. To their surprise, the cabinets were filled with gold, precious stones, and stacks of money. Once all of the boxes were open, Matthew took box number 175 and placed it in one of their loot bags. After gathering all of the jewelry from the safe and securing their treasure in separate bags, Matthew and the three elderly men went their separate ways. Terry and Danny would continue to collect the remaining gold and diamonds. When Matthew arrived at the alley, he quickly called Judas to pick him up, intending to take him away to the hideout. He had brought a large and valuable diamond as a sign of gratitude, not realizing that Judas had been betraying him from the start by informing Frank of his whereabouts. As Matthew prepared to sort through the loot, Frank appeared with a gun pointed at him and demanded that he hand over box number 175, as it did not belong to him. Therefore, Frank requested that Matthew place half of his loot into a bag, with the intention of taking even more from their previous deal. Matthew, not daring to argue, complied with the demand. Suddenly, Erzabet appeared on the scene with two of her subordinates. Frank was forced to abandon his plan to rob Matthew and surrender. Erzabet was filled with curiosity about the contents of the box, and upon opening it, she was surprised to find that it held information related to Marcus' secret. But Erzabet was not interested in keeping the contents of the box for herself. She was not driven by greed and only took the 14 million pounds that was agreed upon in their previous deal. She understood that greed would only lead to misery and could potentially cause conflict in the future. Fortunately for Frank, Matthew was not a cruel or vengeful person. Despite holding a gun on Frank, Matthew offered to let him take the box as they had originally agreed. But just as Frank was about to leave, Matthew called him back and proposed a new deal. He offered Frank a quarter of the loot in exchange for Frank wiping clean his criminal record. The following day, Frank met with Marcus and handed over the contents of the box. Marcus was pleased with Frank's delivery and quickly went on his way. Meanwhile, Matthew roamed freely with a backpack filled with treasures, planning to travel to different countries where he would be unknown. The city of London was in an uproar as news of the biggest heist in British history made headlines. 200 million pounds had vanished without a trace, and the public was left wondering who was behind the crime. Meanwhile, Brian and the other older men were enjoying their retirement by partying and having fun with the money they had earned. However, history repeated itself once again, as Judas was caught selling his diamonds in various locations. Terry, Danny Collins, and Brian were arrested and sentenced to 6 years in prison. On the other hand, Matthew was still free to roam, as Matthew was not his real name. No one knew where he was or his true identity, as he had purposely used the name Matthew as a pseudonym from the start. Unbeknownst to the older men, it was revealed that Matthew had deliberately spiked Brian's food with a toxic substance, causing a reaction after 20 minutes of consumption. He had also been the one to intentionally cut the hydraulic cable to halt their work. His intention was to eliminate the clever Brian and smoothly carry out his plan. From the start, Matthew had purposely taken the older men as victims in the major theft scheme. Matthew also discovered Judah's treachery and reached out to Erzabet to handle Frank. Knowing Frank's greedy nature, the deal Matthew made with him was to take care of the arrests of Judas and the older men. Additionally, Matthew had also made a deal with Marcus, an influential official who was able to quickly close the case after the arrest of Brian and the others without further investigation. The moral of this story is to always stay alert and not trust others too readily. Trust is earned and should be given cautiously. It is important to always be aware of your surroundings and to be mindful of whom you trust. Betrayal can come from unexpected places, so it's important to be cautious and keep an eye out for warning signs.